morning, church. Welcome. Praise God. Another Sunday. Good to be in the house of the God again. I just want to share with you Galatians 5, verse 16. I say then, walk in the Spirit, and you shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. For the flesh lusts against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh. And these are contrary to one another, so that you do not do the things that you wish. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under the law. And then Paul talks about the works of the flesh and so on. And we all have a internal battle with the flesh. As Paul says, that they're at enmity with one another. And there's practical things that we can do to walk in the Spirit. We have God's word as well and his promises. We need to continually be in prayer and fasting with certain things as well, and keep looking to him, having constant communion and fellowship with God, and not letting the desires of the flesh rise up. It's like when you go on a diet, you have to cut out certain foods. Some of you might go to the fridge, you find a bit of chocolate, and a little bit of chocolate's not going to hurt, and you have a bit, and then the next day comes along, you have a little bit more, you have a little bit more, and then before you know it, you've had the whole bar. And it's the same with sin as well. The more we entertain it, the more you're going to want to do it. That's why we need to take practical steps to stop and fast from certain things as well. When I was coming to church, there was many things that I had to do to cut off. I had to cut off certain people. I had to cut off social media. I had to take action. And all of us need to take action. We're all on a journey. And thank God, God's got our back. That's all I can say. Also, I want to encourage you as well. On Friday, we had a really powerful message shared by the senior pastor. If you haven't heard it, I would encourage you to watch it online. I finished at the boxing club and watched it as soon as I got home. I was really tired. But Penny kept on saying my name. She kept on saying, Andrew, Andrew, Andrew. Wake up. Exactly. Wake up. And come to me when Jesus said, could you not stay out for 1 hour and pray? And she kept on saying my name. But it was a really powerful word. And especially she was sharing a testimony from someone called Andrew, who was a pastor in Turkey. Watch it yourselves. I won't go over it all, but it was an amazing testimony. And you know, as I was saying earlier, everyone's journey is unique. And when he was in prison, he felt so distanced from God, as if God wasn't there with him. But if you haven't watched it, watch it. And let's prepare our hearts for the message that's going to go out in power today as I pass over to the praise team. God bless you all.
I see the evidence of your goodness all over my life. Amen. All throughout my history, your faithfulness has walked beside me. The winter storms made way for spring in every season from where I'm standing. And help me remember when I'm weak. Fear may come, but fear will leave. You lead my heart to victory, and you are my strength, and you always will be. And I see the cross, the empty grave. The evidence is endless. All my sin rolled away because of you, oh Jesus. So let's stand this morning as we come into praise and worship. Let's leave everything at the feet of Jesus this morning. Let's really come into that place where we're truly going to meet with our Lord and Maker this morning. God bless you.
I see the evidence of your good all over. your promises. Fear will leave.
Fear may come, but fear will leave.
Hallelujah.
You need my heart to victory.
You're my strength, God, and you always will be.
You are my strength, and you always
I see
will
the evidence.
Be. I see the evidence of your good.
Confess it over our lives.
All over my
confess the promises of God over your lives this morning. See the evidence. God is a good God.
The promises in fulfillment.
His track record is good. Time and again, what he has done before, he can do again and again and again. I see.
I see the evidence of your goodness all over my life.
Evidence that the sun is shining,
and I see the evidence of your goodness all over my life, all over my life. I see the promises in fulfillment all over my life, all over my life.
Your eyes, from whence comes your help?
The evidence is endless. All my sin rolled away because of you, oh Jesus.
See the cross this morning, church. The finished work of Calvary. It is finished. Sickness bows. Sin bows. It is finished. I see the cross. I see the empty grave. I see the wounds in his hands. I see the resurrected Savior. I see the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of this world. I see the Lamb upon his shoulders. I see him carrying our burdens.
See the cross.
The evidence is endless. Endless, endless. The steadfast love is new.
Because of you.
Goodness
all over
my life,
all over. presence is here.
Why should I fear?
Why should I fear?
Oh, the evidence. Why should I fear? And that we are seeking, that we may dwell in the house of the Lord for the days of our lives. The evidence is here that He made a way where there was no way, that He enlarged the ground beneath our feet, that He said that no weapon formed against us would ever prosper. He said He'll never leave us nor forsake us. He's God and not man that He should lie. Why should I fear man? What can man do to us? Lord, we worship You. Why should I fear the evidence? Hallelujah. Praise You, Jesus. To You belongs the glory. To You belongs the praise and the honor. Almighty God, maker of heaven and earth. The evidence is here.
Praise God, church. We have much to celebrate this morning. As you can see, we're celebrating Archbishop's 20th year of being a bishop. So there's a lot to celebrate. I'm actually really moved. So we just have to pretend that he's not here. But, you know, just there's so much that I can say, but we're going to show a short video, and I believe that it says it all. We just want to thank God for His life, really thank God for His life. And I've been sharing with the leadership. You know, we've worked together for so many years, and I have just seen such consistency, such tenacity, such commitment, and just such a sweet, sweet heart. Sometimes there are challenges in ministry, but He stood the test of time. And I just want to thank God for His life. Let's give the Lord a clap off. And we're going to show this short video now. In fact, can I just change that, Stav? Because people are still making their way, and I don't want them to actually miss it. So we're going to take our offering. Let's just be prayerful. I want to thank Layla, actually, who put the video together. It makes me laugh because Archbishop wants a video put together that we're going to show for all our live streaming about our church, to give people some details about who we are. And he's been asking for about 3 weeks, but unbeknown to him, because he didn't know we're doing this video or anything else for that matter, but unbeknown to him that Layla was busy. And he said to me, it's been 3 weeks, as though, you know, well, when's this video coming? When's it going to happen? I need the, you know, because Archbishop wants things done yesterday. He's actually got much, much better with time, hasn't he? He's much, much more patient and more gracious. But praise be to God. So, Dominic, before we do take the offering, because I want us to be present. People are still making their way. And for those of you who are watching at home also, you're welcome. Another Sunday service. I thank God that we can be here. So much has happened this past week, but we're still standing. And we're standing better than we ever have. So that when we draw close to God, He draws close to us. And He's a good God. His track record is so good. Praise God. So let's just lift up another worship song as people are making their way. And then we'll have our time of offering.
You are worthy of it all. Amen. This is all the saints and angels, they bow before your throne, and all the elders cast their crowns before the Lamb of God and sing, you are worthy of it all. For from you are all things, and to you are all things, for you deserve the glory. Amen.
Should we stand? Let's just stand. There's a sweet anointing in the house this morning. That means you desire to draw close to him. And I pray every blessing upon your lives. I know that Archbishop has a word for us in due season. I know that I need him more today. Truly, and I don't say that lightly, there's been some challenges for me last night within my family. But praise God that I'm still in church. And I know that God is fighting our corner. So we're standing this morning, unite in prayer, cover each other's family and friends and loved ones. And God knows, we're going to sing, you are worthy of it all. Archbishop Edmund and Bishop Noel. Praise God. And as the baskets are placed, in fact, just people are getting confused. This was my idea, isn't it, putting a basket either side, but people are getting confused which basket to put. So let's just leave the one there. God bless you. So as you're led row by row, be blessed as you give and be in anticipation for God to do something new in our lives. Every time we come together, we need to encourage our spirit, speak to our soul, preach to our doubt, overcome our fears. We are spiritual beings, we often say, but we're sharing a human experience. And our human nature sometimes betrays us. But don't be anxious. Be anxious for nothing. In prayer, it says, and supplication, with thanksgiving in your heart. You just make your request known to God. Don't worry about what you're feeling this morning. Just decide in your spirit that you will open your heart, that you ask God to speak to you, and He will. You know, Andrew shared about the word on Friday, and I know that what spoke to me, it was about, long story, it's a book, but President Trump fought so hard to release this pastor, so hard. He moved heaven and earth to get him home. And it spoke to me, because if a mere human being can move heaven and earth and do everything in his ability to get that young Andrew, that pastor, home, how much more is our Heavenly Father going to do everything in His ability to get me and you home? Irrespective of what we're going through, irrespective of the challenges, He doesn't look at our failings. He looks at His Son. And in His Son, everything is yes and amen. I want to encourage you, don't be afraid of emotions. Emotions are like the clouds. They come and go. Be a spectator, an observer, as Bishop says. See the emotions, see the thoughts, but don't think that they are you, because that's the voice of the enemy. When you have opposing thoughts or feelings to what you know as a Christian you should be living, the enemy condemns us, but the Holy Spirit never condemns you. There is no condemnation in Jesus Christ. He will convict you. But conviction is healing. It brings change. So don't be anxious about what you think this morning. Allow the Holy Spirit to speak, because he so wants to. God bless you as you give.
Broken.
Welcome, Archbishop Fringpong. Also, your jacket matches my laces. You're very flamboyant, Archbishop. Praise God. Let's pray. Going to pray for the offering, for the children, for the word, and for this precious, precious video. God bless you, Layla. God has really allowed, you're allowing God to use your gifts, and I really thank God for your life. And also, Shenis, do you want to say a few words about what God is doing in your life before we come? Yeah, from there. I just want to give God glory because he's using people.
Amen. Hello, everyone. Recently, well, for the past year, I've been very confused with what I'm doing with my life. I was working in music and doing stuff, and basically, because of lockdown and everything, it went downhill, and God was saying through that time to make music for him, and I was, for a very long time, denying it or just ignoring it because I thought I could progress in music in my own way. But basically, I've been working on music for him, and it's just, I'm releasing it monthly now, and I'm just letting God do whatever he wants to do with it. So, I just thank God. He's so good. He's so good because I went from knowing nothing, like I didn't know, and to knowing what God wanted me to do, and I feel peace about it, and yeah, letting him take control, all for him. Amen.
Praise God. So as a church, we want to support our young people especially. Like we're coming behind Ezra Taylor, who's one of our young boxers. And as a church, we want to just surround them with goodness and with faith and with vision. Same with Layla, same with Shenis, same with myself, because I still class myself as young. But still, so praise God. Without further ado, we pray for the offering, for our children, for our church, for every aspect of our ministry. Again, for our Archbishop that we celebrate today. And we give God the glory in Jesus' name.
Your dear family, your dear congregation.
Hi, Costas.
Dear Costakis.
Hi, Costas. Hope you're well.
Hi, Archbishop.
Oh, hi, Costakis.
Hi, Costas Evangelou.
Archbishop.
Hi, Bishop.
Hi, Costas.
Archbishop Costakis Evangelou, my dear colleague and brother in faith.
I understand you've got a great anniversary coming up, 20 years.
Costakis, we thank God for you for the 20 years that he's blessed you to lead his people.
Congratulations, Your Eminence. It has been 20 years since you were consecrated into the office of a bishop.
As we celebrate your 20th anniversary of your consecration as a bishop, I wish to congratulate you.
We are so proud and so thankful for knowing you, and you are such a good inspiration to us. You're such a great leader.
I just want to congratulate you on your 20-year anniversary.
My friend Bishop Evangelou on an outstanding achievement, coming up soon, 20 years.
Congratulations, Your Eminence. I want to especially congratulate you on behalf of Dr. Che and Mrs. Che and the entire Unity Church family.
I'm so delighted to hear that you knew the news that you've made it to 20 years. What an incredible achievement.
This is to wish you many, many congratulations.
To wish you well in the 20 years, probably more, that you've been in the ministry serving the Lord.
It's good to be here to wish you congratulations.
Congratulations for you all.
I'm sending out my best congratulations and love to Archbishop Costakis for this great anniversary. I really can recall a wonderful career by the grace of God in those 20 years. Archbishop Costakis' spiritual journey was a really wonderful journey, which can teach anyone just watching the stages of his advancement and how he ended up to be an archbishop in this country and in Ghana.
It is good at these sort of anniversaries to reflect and look at your achievements over that period of time. In the church, in the work in the community, fighting poverty in Edmonton and abroad, with regards to education and deepening of faith, of care and of Christian unity.
The Christian way and the love he used as the main weapon during all these years.
Costas, I first met you when Edmonton Eagles was put forward for the Queen's Award for Voluntary Service. I didn't realise at the time, but that was just one example of your hard work and dedication to improving the lives of others.
Evangelou. You've inspired many lives, obviously helping me achieve my dreams as well. I can only imagine it's not just me that you have a very big impact on.
Everyone that I spoke to said that you were the sort of person that made them want to be a better person. I agree with that wholeheartedly.
You touch people's lives for the better in just so many ways.
With the able help of Penny and your terrific team of deacons, you have achieved far more than most would ever even dream of. Recognised by your country, the monarchy.
Archbishop Kostakis Evangelou for services to young people in North London.
Having worked with you for 2 years, I've seen firsthand how exceptional you are. Your contributions have been absolutely invaluable, and the lives that you've affected personally, yourself, and when working with the police, it's been incredible.
With your wonderful team, so being kindly supporting our mosque as a friend of Rumi, but also feeding the homeless, helping the needy, and looking after the youth through various sport activities and advocating peace and interfaith activities in the community. Therefore, you are truly a gem to the community.
It has been hard work in all these 20 years. Never once have you compromised with your conviction. You have kept your integrity, and this is a sign of a true leadership.
It's that time that we celebrate, and we are celebrating our great Archbishop. May his blessings go with you, and may he continuously to keep you in all your endeavors.
And I pray that the Lord continue to fulfill every mission and every dream of your life to enable you to serve your community.
It's an honour and a great pleasure to class you as a friend of mine, a very close and good friend and mentor. I thank the Lord for the day that we met and coming to meet you and your people at the church, the most fantastic church.
I'm so grateful to have met you through Father Maximus for all the things that you do, especially writing those two excellent pieces for I Believe.
Thank you so much for accepting your call and encouraging us to accept our call.
Very proud to count you as a friend, and it's an achievement that you can rightly be proud of, and your entire family as well.
I just want to thank you. Everything you do, be a positive role model in my life. Such a good friend, and I love you so, so much.
This journey that we've been on as a colleague, but more importantly as a friend, has been fantastic.
And we thank God for how far he's brought you. We pray that God will continue to lift you higher and higher and take you to greater heights, and be a blessing to many nations.
Thank you for all of the help that you've contributed to the community in Enfield and Haringey. Thank you so much, and enjoy this amazing achievement.
Thank you for all that you have done and you continue to do, particularly for the community of Enfield.
I thank you for all the work that you've done with us.
I pray God Almighty allows you to continue to serve him and the community.
I wish he will continue for another 50 years at least.
Now here's to another 20 years.
Many congratulations, Pastor. I hope you enjoy your day.
I just want to wish you well in all you do, and it's great to be your friend.
I'm so glad to know you. Have a great, great celebration.
Congratulations again. Well done. An outstanding achievement. And I'm just sending my best wishes. God bless.
Very, very warmest wishes on this important anniversary. Many, many more years to come.
A great and wholehearted congratulations.
Congratulations on the 20th anniversary. Have a fantastic day.
Congratulations, Archbishop. We're very happy for you.
We wish we were with you.
It's a fantastic achievement. I wish you all the best. God be with you.
Hopefully you have a wonderful anniversary.
Congratulations. Have a wonderful day as you celebrate this very special anniversary.
We love and appreciate you. We thank you for being a blessing to us.
The Lord bless you.
Amen. I want to congratulate you for setting yourself apart for the gospel of Christ and the service of God's people.
God loves you. God loves you. And God loves you.
I am sending my heartfelt wishes and prayers to you, to your family, and the community.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine over you and be for you merciful. The Lord make his face shine over you and give for you all shalom, good, healthy, long life, and success by going and coming. Joy in the Lord is your strength. Blessings, greetings, very warm greetings.
And our young students have a message for you.
Congratulations,
congratulations, young man.
Congratulations.
God bless you, sir.
God bless you. We love you. Happy anniversary.
So don't ever stop, no matter what, 'cause you're gonna make it.
Praise God. Praise God. If you'd like to take your seats. We've also, we've got something for you. And this is a book that the church and the wider community have put together in his service 20 years. There are hundreds of languages around the world, but a smile speaks them all. Messages.
Amen. Let's be upstanding as we invite Archbishop to come and share the word this morning. God bless you.
Please take your seats, please. You want me to share after that? Wow, I didn't know that was coming. Just see. Wow. I won't read it now, I'll read it later. Sorry? Okay, so thank you. God bless you. Let's just turn to your neighbor, wave to each other, just acknowledge each other's presence here. Greet you all the ministers in the house, all the visitors in the house. Bishop-elect Leo is at the back, I believe. I didn't notice him last week, but he's there. God with his family and the visitors as well. You're welcome. Welcome. Bishop Archbishop Frimpong and Bishop Archbishop Edmund, Bishop Noah, you're all welcome. God bless you. I'm trying to collect my thoughts to come to the message. Actually, I've got this new contraption. It's there. Let's see if this works. Can I see if it works? Is it on the overhead? Does it work? Is it working? Thank you. How do I raise it? Okay, we got that. We worked that out. God bless. Well, before I actually come to the message, just want to acknowledge a few things. God, are you still with me? I don't know what's happening today, but God bless. I want to just bring to mind Marina. Is she here? Where's Marina? Is she here today? She's not here. Well, her parents passed away within the space of 10 days between each one. There's no Simeon and Francois. Simeon died within approximately 10 days between each other. I want to lift them to the Lord. Also, I want to just bring to mind Sister Ruth's sister, Mavis, who also passed away this weekend. And any other bereavements you've had, we want to just commit them to the Lord. So let's stand together in prayer and just thank the Lord for their lives, for what they contributed within their families, and just seek God's comfort and consolation at this time. And anyone else who suffered the bereavement or lost, people watching live stream at home, we'll just commit you to the Lord as well. Father, we thank you for your love. I thank you for every special person here, Lord. We are on a journey, Lord. We're just looking to you for direction, for strength, for encouragement, for comfort, to look beyond our limitations, to see the bigger picture, the bigger plan you have for each one of our lives. As we surrender to you, Lord, we give you the praise, the glory, the preeminence. And together the church will say amen, amen, amen and amen. Praise God. God bless you. Please take your seats. Amen. Today's message, the title for today's message is Power of Words. Amen. We'll look for different facets, how we use our words, how we speak to each other, what we listen to, what we acknowledge, what we really receive, what the things we internalize that change our lives, and how we embrace things and how we translate things in our mind changes everything. You know, you determine your future. Actually, your future is in your hands, not in anyone else's hands. It's what you accept, what you embrace, and how you act, what you hear, that makes the difference. Praise God. The words are very important. In fact, when God created the heavens and the earth and the universe, as we believe the narrative of the gospel, there has to be a creator, because things didn't just come about as they are. Often people speak about evolution, but that's the theory of evolution. It's easier to believe in a creator than evolution. Because if you know the way the science of evolution, how they explain creation came about, it's hard to believe. I wish I'm speaking to someone. It's easier to believe in a true living God and a creator than to believe in the system of evolution with no mind behind it. Because in life there is a design. It's not haphazard. There is a design behind everything. The chair you're sitting on did not evolve and you came and found it there. I wish I'm speaking to someone. There was a mind, a design behind it. The universe is more complex than the chair you're sitting on. And to believe that it came by haphazard, by chance, it's beyond reason, beyond understanding. It's difficult to accept that when there is a design, there's a plan behind it. I wish the universe is a cycle of the sun and how the planets rotate around the sun and so forth. That is more complicated than the watch you wear on your hands. And it would be far-fetched to believe that the watch you wear on your hands just appeared on your hand. I wish I'm speaking to her. It's the same way that you get some metal, some wires, some plastic, and you put it and you throw it in the air, and it lands in the shape of an aeroplane. That's the basis what evolution believes. They don't know if it's true or not, but they don't have another model because they have arguments against a creator, a designer. Praise God. God is better than Hugo Boss. God is better designer than Versace. Yeah? Praise God. And any other brands you might know. I don't know too many, but any other brands. Because you see what you get with me. I'm the same yesterday, today, and forever. You're wearing the same. So everything began with words. When God created the universe, it's the power of sound that brought about creation. There's a certain vibration. God didn't begin by writing, let there be. He spoke it. It was a spoken word. There's power in a word. I want to drop a few things into your mind to show you that how you speak will determine how you progress or how you move back, how you prosper or how you can become impoverished in yourself. It's all dependent how you think and what you say. Sometimes you sabotage your future by naively speaking things that block your passage in moving on to achieve what you should be achieving. Yeah, come on. Yeah? Praise God. So I want to begin with the very beginning. I want to drop a few things into your spirit. In Genesis, the power of words now. This is the power of words we're speaking about. In Genesis chapter 1, verse 1 to 3, we have the embryo beginning of creation. The word Genesis, it comes from a Greek word. Genesis means to be born. Yeah? Genesis, now genazt, means to be give birth. Yeah? And so it's the birth certificate of the world. Genesis is the birth certificate of creation. And often people argue, did God create the world in 6 days or so forth? Well, let me tell you something to you. A day to the Lord, 1,000 years is like a day to the Lord. You know when the Lord was going towards Jerusalem before he was betrayed? And he came across the fig tree. And we're told he was hungry in the Gospel of Matthew. He was hungry at the beginning of his ministry, and he was hungry at the end of his ministry. He fasted for 40 days and 40 nights, and we're told he was hungry. But his hunger is not our hunger. He said, blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be filled. What are you hungering for today? And as he approached at the end of his ministry, he saw the fig tree, and it says he was hungry. He knew the times, he knew the seasons, but the fig tree stood as a metaphor to represent something else. And it was representing his people. And he had no fruit on the fig tree. There was no fruit. All there was leaves. And we know right back in Genesis at the beginning when Adam and Eve transgressed and disobeyed God that they hid behind the fig leaves because the leaves of the fig tree represented excuses. Leaves mean excuses. We want to excuse, we want to complain and things like this. And he saw the fig and he cursed the fig tree. Come on, I want you to just take your mind there. Let's go back 2,000 or so years ago where Jesus was ministering. He passed and he cursed the fig tree. And the disciples were there and watching, observing what was happening. As soon as he cursed the fig tree, the Bible says immediately the fig tree withered. But if you taught a scientist in that context and the scientist was going to analyze that fig tree, the process of time for that fig tree to wither to that condition would have taken months or years, but God bypassed the time of humanity and it was immediately withered. So when God says he created the world in 6 days, his 6 days are not your 6 days. What takes a billion years to us is a moment in time for God. I wish I'm speaking to someone. Hallelujah. So right at the beginning, God gives us a narrative of creation. And he says, by verse 3, this is what the Hebrew says. Verse 3, it says this. Then God said, let there be light. And there was light. It says, and God said. The Hebrew word is ve-yomer. Ve-yomer. God said, let there be light. And there was light. He spoke it and it came into existence, creation. Yeah, he wanted to, the chaos of darkness, he wanted to transform it. So he brought light, praise God, at the beginning. And God's plan for your life and my life is to give us light, to give us life and more abundantly, so that we do not walk around in darkness. But there's a mystery in relation to even the words in the Hebrew. Okay, and I just want to write something. I want to write the Hebrew word that represents said, to say, or said, past tense. Yeah? Okay, so the Hebrew word, you got that? I'm going to write it on this thing, try and use this contraption here. Okay, right, so let's see if it works. Okay. Okay, can you see? I don't know if it's the right way around. No, it's going so. Let me turn it to the side. Am I writing it wrong? Let me do it again. Turn it that way. Sorry about this. It's the first time I'm using this, but I thought it would be good to use it. Okay. That's Aleph, Mem, Resh. That's good. It's better. It looks all right. Okay. The first Hebrew letter is Aleph. The second is Mem. The third is Resh. The first represents number one, and it speaks about God. Okay, so it's the actual meaning is an ox, or represents God, or represents power. The number two, Mem, represents water. And the last letter, Resh, represents the head, or authority, or is the first letter that spells the word Ruah, which is spirit. Okay? And this is translated as Sed. Okay? Sed. Thank you. But if you break this word up and you take these two first letters, they say the word mother. So the implication is this: when you speak, your mother gives birth. So you speak in something, mother births. In fact, Socrates once said that he wants to be a midwife, that he wants to encourage your words, that you speak words, to birth words, wisdom, to birth ideas, to birth the philosophy of the meaning of life. That's what Socrates' role was, to help his students give birth to ideas. So when we're speaking, whatever you're saying, there's an outcome to what you are saying. Yeah? So whatever you say will have an outcome. You're going to give birth. You can give birth to good, or you can give birth to bad things. Yeah? Because the consequences of your life, in your journey in life, are determined what you're processing in your mind and what you're pronouncing. If you're negative about yourself, you're going to block your passage. If you keep thinking, I can't do this, or you think that something is impossible for you within limitation, guess what? You're going to have the outcome of what you're confessing. That's why it's important to speak, confess the promises of God over your lives, to remove all the obstacles and all the barriers that you can move forward to overcome. If you are impoverished and you keep confessing your condition, you're going to stay in that place. That's why the scripture says, let the weak say they are strong. Because you're not confessing the condition you are experiencing, you're confessing the outcome you want. Yeah, you're visionary, you're looking ahead to what you want to overcome. Let the poor, let the weak say they are strong. Whatever, doesn't matter what you're going through, your strength comes from God. Because the joy of the Lord is my strength, is your strength. So when you're confessing the positive, you attract the power, the vibration of the outcome is attracted to you and becomes a stepping stone and the bridge to get you to the place you are confessing to be in. Come on. So let the poor say they are rich. Say, confess, my poverty days are over. My days of failure are over. I'm confessing success. I'm confessing prosperity, body, soul, and spirit. You are the orchestrator. You are the one who determines how you progress. You will hear many things spoken about you, to you, at you. But you don't need to internalize those. You send them back to sender. Return to sender. Praise God. So built in the word, in the Hebrew, the word God said is the mechanism of bringing things about, which is birth. There's a mystery there that we need to embrace and need to act upon. Don't be hearers of the word, but be doers of the word. How you speak will determine your condition. And what you embrace and accept and believe will bring those outcomes. People are often sick when they do not need to be sick. People are emotionally broken when they don't need to be emotionally broken. Because if you're depending, if your emotion, your joy is dependent on the things around you, you're setting yourself up for disappointment. Come on, I wish I'm speaking to someone. Yeah? If you're saying, Joe Bloggs is going to make me happy if I marry him, you're setting yourself up for disappointment. If you say this job, if I get this degree, I'm going to be the happiest person in the world, you're setting yourself up for disappointment. Because there's an emptiness that only one entity can fill. All the money in the world cannot fill it. All the success in the world cannot fill it. All the friends in the world cannot fill it. Only God can fill that void that you have. Jesus said, what would it profit a man to gain the whole world and lose his soul? And we try and fill our emptiness with things that are perishable goods that are passing away. Yeah? And when God enters your life, the joy is internal, not external. It's subjective, not objective, praise God. But it's how we're speaking that determines that outcome. You see, even doctors and scientists know how to get people to a place of positivity by using something called placebo. Who's heard of the placebo effect? It's medication that has got no healing property in it. It's just powders. There's nothing medicinal in that placebo tablet. But they give it to patients and they try this experiment saying, if you take this tablet, it's going to help you with your headache. It's going to help you with your emotion. It's going to help you with your stomach problem. And people take this not knowing it's a placebo, but because they believe in what's been suggested to them, they feel the symptoms, the outcome of what's expected of them, and they start the body starts healing itself, not because of placebo, but because of their faith that's connected to the placebo. I wish I'm speaking to someone. This has been scientifically tested and verified. You can check it on your YouTube, Googles, Snapchat, whatever you've got. Okay? It's power of suggestion belief. But the negative works as powerful as the positive. If someone says to you, you're sick, see, are you okay? You look bad. You look anemic. You look, what's wrong with you? You look upset. You get it. If you accept that confession, you start, is there something wrong with me? Oh, well, I'm not feeling that great. But if you say, you're looking so fantastic. Sorry? People, like, you don't, when you're, be careful when someone says, how does this dress look on me? Does this dress suit me? You've got to be careful how you answer these things. Be wise. Power of the word. And this is why the social media is dangerous. Because uneducated and unqualified people are telling people, giving people information that's not verified, not based on facts or truth. And people internalize it and start to believe it. And fear, because the power of fear operates in that way, in ignorance. And people become sick. Not because they're sick, but because they believe they believe the lie. The devil is a liar. You know, if you recall, before the turn of the 20th century, the millennium, in 1999, who remembers the fear-mongering that was spread throughout the world, that the millennium bug, now we've got the COVID-19, but then we had the millennium bug. And said, once 1999 becomes the 12 o'clock, turns into 2020, all the computers are going to break down. Bank systems are going to go down. Aeroplanes, if they're flying, they're going to fall out the sky because the computers cannot deal the change of the decimal, how the computers are supposed to function and work. And everyone was so afraid. They were stocking up food in their cupboards at home because they thought everything was going to crash. 2020 came without an incident. But many people made a lot of money for selling their books. Come on. we have the same situation, because people like to fearmonger. And you need to get fact. You need to be factual about the information you get. Yeah? So it's power of the word, but people speak words, and we need to be careful what we accept and what we reject. The wise person rejects and says, let me get my facts before I accept or acknowledge anything. That's very, very important, because there's power in the word. Solomon, in Proverbs 15:23, said this: a man has joy by the answer of his mouth, and a word spoken in due season has good, how good it is. So when you speak, be connected to people who validate you, who encourage you, who lift you up. Don't be around negativity all the time. It'll bring you down. It'll make you sick, physically, spiritually, and emotionally sick. Praise God. Because when people speak, they're birthing something into your life. Solomon tells us in Proverbs 18, verse 21, death and life are in the power of the tongue, and those who love it will eat its fruit. Yeah? So how we speak, you can help someone be lifted up or bring them down. Very important how we speak through our life's journey. I refuse to accept negative reports. I refuse to engage in gossip. I refuse. Because you know what that does? It kills my soul. It kills your soul. When you start criticizing, it comes back to you. Yeah? You've got to be careful how you speak and who you speak with. That's why the Lord tells us in Matthew 5:37, but let your yes be yes and your no, no. For whatever is more than these is from the evil one. Meaning that the vibrations you give out can work negative. There'll be a negative repercussion coming back to you. It depends on the length you speak about things. Yeah? So speak the promises of God, and you see the godly outcomes, which are very, very important. This is a principle that has been long forgotten over the centuries, but it was known by the ancients. The ancients knew the power of the word. Witchcraft is based on spells on the power of the word. Witches know more about the power of the word than supposed to be Christians and people of God, who should have the word. That's why God calls himself the word. In the beginning was the word. And the word was with God, and the word. And the word, in the beginning was the word, and the word was with God, and the word was God. The word, speak the word of God. Changes everything. Whenever in our, we've been 20 years now, thank God, thank you for the celebration. Thank everyone who, really, I was moved and humbled by the wonderful words that were spoken. I didn't realize I had done, that's just a snippet of the work we have done as a people and as a church. Because no one is an island, it's a team. So what's representative is the tireless hard work of everyone else around us. I was speaking to Luke, actually, the other day, and we're speaking about people leaving churches. And I said to Luke, if you recall, I said, don't look at the people who leave the church. Look at the people who stay and see what they have achieved. That's the most important thing. It's not people are going to come and go, but the ones who stayed make the difference. The fact that these ones stayed. How many were around Jesus? In the Gospel of John chapter 6, verse 66. Let me just go. John 6, 6. Funny enough, 666. From that time, many of his disciples went back and walked with him no more. But Jesus was not preoccupied with the ones who walked with him no more. He was concerned with the ones who were walking with him. Because I don't want to walk with the wrong people. I don't want to walk along, come alongside people who are going to lead me in the wrong path, in the wrong direction, and cause me to have spiritual bankruptcy and spiritual shipwreck, or sabotage my journey. I want to walk with the right people. And verse 67 said this, watch this. Then Jesus said to the 12, do you also want to go away? Can you imagine? There was thousands around him. Everyone left, and there was only about 12 left. Some people will consider this a failure in his ministry. But it's not the amount of people. It's the quality and character of the people. Come on. So don't worry if not everyone is singing your praises. You're in good company. Jesus had the same things. Amen. We all have the same things. I recall many years ago, the very beginning, many years ago, before I was consecrated bishop, we were doing outreaches in the community. And we wanted to advertise in a particular newspaper. Do you recall that? And the editor got the advert and refused to publish it. because it was anti what we were representing. And I said, don't worry, just give it to God. Within a few weeks, that editor was removed from their position and another editor was put and they published it. And the new editor has become one of my closest friends over the years. And I've been more in that paper than any magazine. Come on. See, it's true. Yeah? What I'm saying, don't go by what people are. Just you trust God. It's his business. You're employed by him. He's your employer. He's the government over you. You have diplomatic rights in him. When there's a problem with a diplomat, the government that diplomat represents steps in and intervenes on behalf of the diplomat. You have diplomatic immunity in the kingdom of God. And you move in the power of the Holy Spirit. Oh, hallelujah. And Penny was saying, so interestingly, but this was in Turkey, where the regime, anyone who was educated or questioned the regime was put into prison. And this pastor was put into prison. And Donald Trump himself, that people don't know these things behind the scenes, put an embargo on Turkey and said, if that man is not released, I'm going to cut all your supplies and your economy is going to plummet. And he hit them hardly for one man, as Penny was saying, because that man, there was a connection with that government. We have the greatest government. We have the kingdom of God. So if God's employed you to serve his purpose, trust him. For myself, whether there's one person or a billion people, I don't care. I'm just working for him. Amen. There was no clause saying every time you minister, everyone has to love you. That when you minister, people are going to open doors for you. Or they're going to support you. Sometimes they'll slap you. Metaphorically, but sometimes physically. Sometimes they'll rebuke you. Sometimes they'll challenge you. Sometimes they close doors in your face. But when one door closes, God has a better one for you. And when God opens that better door, no one can close that door. Come on, I wish. Watch this. Verse 68. Watch this. But Simon Peter answered him, Lord, to whom should we go? You have the words of eternal life. So it's not the numbers, it's the attitude, the character, the quality of those around you. You can do more with a few who are fully committed than with multitudes who are indifferent. The evidence is there. Look at Gideon. There was 32,000. It's too many. They're just going to be indifferent. They're just going to get in each other's way. You're going to fight against yourselves. If I have to force someone to serve in the kingdom of God, forget about it. Because when you serve God, the only one who benefits is yourself. Yeah? Don't think that I didn't have adversity, didn't have opposition, didn't have difficulties. We all have it. The difference is we've decided to follow Jesus and no turning back. And that's why when I look in the backdrop, I had a lot more hair. It was dark at the time. Yeah, and things are changing. But the ancients knew the power of words. So start speaking. The greatest weapon you have is your word. Father Maximus was saying, is that the weapons we had were love, encouragement, and servitude. That's our weapons. But you have a great weapon. That's the weapon of how you speak. Because let me say something to you that people are not aware of this. You can become a prisoner of your words. You can become a prisoner of other people's words. Yeah? Because when you give a vibration that's negative, the first person it impacts is you. People don't know. People think I'm just giving lip service. I'm telling you through life, I've seen the mighty fall because of the way they use their words. I see people professing so many great things, but their words didn't align and their actions with what they were saying. And it was detrimental to them. But the ancients knew the power of words. And there's a number of amazing examples I just want to recount as we journey this morning to encourage you how you use your words, confess your words. Attract the angelic support, not the demonic presence. You get that when you get home. Because the source of love, of encouragement, of peace is God. The source of criticisms, complaining, embitterment is the devil. And you be the judge for yourself. How you speak will determine the water you draw from. If I had the contaminated water here, and I invite you to partake of it, you wouldn't come close to it. Well, that water is metaphorically represent how what we have in ourselves. And if people have that in themselves, why are you drawing from that water, from those ideas, from those words? Just push it away and go to the pure water that transforms, that can change you eternally. We have, in the time when the children of Israel left Egypt, they were going to journey through the kingdom of Moab. And Balak, who was the king of the kingdom of Moab, saw what the Israelites were doing, that no conventional weapon could come against them. They brought Jericho down. After the second attempt, they took Ai, for obeying God first, they disobeyed, then obeyed. They took the kingdom of Ai, and they were eating up any empire. They had the power to eat it up. So Balak knew that conventional weapons could not destroy Israel. So what did he do? He said, you know what? I'm going to appeal to the power of the word. Please embrace this, please. Because when I learned the principle, when God revealed to me the principle of the power of words, my life had changed. My life was transformed. I knew that I had within me was the power, by the power of the word, my connection with God, the source of that word. I knew that there was no foe that can come against God. They can come against me, but they cannot come against God. But if I allow God to be enthroned in my heart, I come package, pass and package with God, that if they're coming against me, they're coming against God. So there was a safety net around me. There was a shield around me. God was my shield and my buckler. That's what he said to Abraham. I want to drop this into your spirit, that you can move on and achieve amazing exploits, spiritually, physically, and on every level, by you changing, just retuning your mind and how you speak. So Balak said, I know someone who's like an oracle who pronounces blessings and curses over people. Let me call Balaam, who was a worldly soothsayer. He was like a wizard, if you like, of the time. He said, let me call him, and I'll pay him whatever he wants to stand on a viewpoint and to curse Israel. Because he knew the weapons wouldn't be effective against Israel. No weapon fashioned against you will prosper. He knew that. So he called Balaam, and he said, Balaam, God intervened and said, don't go, because these people are blessed. But then he said, okay, you can go. God consented to him to go. But he nearly struck him on the way on his donkey, and his donkey spoke. Anyway, you read the narrative in Numbers from 22 right through to 23. Watch this. Please, if you get the message today, your mouth will be the greatest weapon, not negatively to use profanities, but how you speak will change not just your destiny, but people around you. Watch this. So he called Balaam and says, I want you to curse Israel by the power of the word. Look, they knew those principles. Spells. Curses. But I'm going to read a few verses just to put the context there. Numbers 23, verse 8. Let me just go a bit before that, just to get the context. Numbers 23, verse 11. Then Balak said to Balaam, what have you done to me? I took you to curse my enemies. And look, you have blessed them bountifully. When he put him into position to curse Israel, instead of Balaam cursing, he started to bless them. Because God took control of his mouth, of his words. Now, Numbers 24:10, again we read this. Then Balak's anger was aroused against Balaam, and he struck his hands together, and Balak said to Balaam, I called you to curse my enemies, and look, you have bountifully blessed them these three times. Every time he was saying curse them, the words were turning. He was blessing them. Whatever, I brought you to be my foe, my co-worker, but you have come against me by the way you're speaking. Yeah? Not by power, not by might, but by my spirit, says the Lord. But watch how Balaam responds to Balak's negativity. Watch this. Numbers 23, verse 8. How shall I curse whom God has not cursed? Yeah. And how shall I denounce whom the Lord has not denounced? So we could apply this to ourselves, church, because you are the blessed of the Lord. You know, the enemy cannot curse you because you're safeguarded. You're Satan-proofed by the presence of the Lord in and around your life. Yeah, yeah. You know? Balak wanted to use the weapon of the tongue. He couldn't use the conventional weapons. But God made a provision, accounted not only for the weapons, but accounted for the curse of the tongue that will not come upon and against his people. I wish I'm speaking to someone. Praise God. And so we read on in Numbers 23, verse 20, says, "Behold, I have received the command to bless. He has blessed, and I cannot reverse it." You know, oftentimes people say, well, someone's put a curse on my family. Someone's put a curse on me. That no curse can have an impact effect on your life once you've come under the covering of the blood of Jesus Christ. Let me make that statement to you. No curse can have a power over you. Isaiah chapter 54 verse 17 tells us, he says this, no weapon, watch this, this is the conventional weapon. No weapon formed against you shall prosper. That's the conventional weapon. But what he goes on to say this, and every tongue, the power of the word, which rises against you in judgment, you should condemn. So it's not just the conventional, but it's the power of the word coming against you. God will chop it down. I wish I'm... Hallelujah, praise God. Because God has already passed his blessing over his people, and it cannot be reversed. The only way you can reverse the blessing is not outside, it's inside. It's how you reject what God has done for you and you give yourself to the elements of the world. You give the world access to you. Oh, hallelujah. So the ancients knew, but I'd encourage you to read the whole narrative because embodied within the blessings of Balaam that God used his mouth to pronounce over Israel was the prophecy of the coming Messiah. Yeah? And in fact, where I was born is mentioned in his prophecy. So read it yourselves. Cyprus is mentioned. Amen, praise God, in those prophecies. So they knew about the power of the word, even to the point when Jesus was ministering, there was a certain centurion who sent some of the Pharisees, some of the Jews, to call Jesus after he saw the mighty works that Jesus was doing. And when Jesus came to the place called Capernaum, as he entered Capernaum, they approached him and said, there's a centurion who's been good to our people. He's invested in our people. One of his servants is sick, who he loves. Can you come and heal him? And Jesus consented. And on the way, the centurion says, you can read this in the Gospel of Luke, chapter 7, right through the chapter. He stops Jesus, and he sends him to stop him. He says, don't come under my roof. I'm not worthy, he said, for you to come into my house. He says, but just say the word. We often want physical presence. We want physical presence. Why didn't he come? Why is it? He said, no, don't come. I'm not worthy, but just say the word. I'm a man who has authority. And I say to this one, do this, and he does it. And I say to the one, do that, and they do it. And I know the power of authority, of speak, of giving instruction. All you need to just speak the word, and my servant shall be made healed, shall be made well. The power of the word. We don't use words. Words, when we use them, must be married with faith. We have to believe what we are saying. That we give ourselves a better advantage over the challenges we have in life. We have to believe. That's why, how do we increase our faith? By being in the Word of God. By reflecting the Word of God. Acting in faith. Walk by faith and not necessarily by sight. You know? You know, this is August, 29th of August, is when God called me into ministry, 1987. It's 34 years. I've seen people come and go. I've been here 34 years in my responsibility. No one promised me anything, but I still consist because I know the King. He called me to serve, and I will never, never, never deny him. Because what he's given is more than the world can offer and give eternity in him. And I know that because, you know, often people say the signs and wonders that had followed this ministry, some of you are not aware of because you see an outcome. You don't see the process. You don't see the dreams. that God has spoken and the outcomes of those particular dreams by detail. No one's seen those. You haven't seen the journey, significant events that took place, that God intervened and confirmed his word and confirmed the calling over our lives. You haven't seen those things. You haven't seen, back in the day, as Penny was saying, I was asking about that. I said, I've this is for 3 weeks now. I called that pastor and said, where's that video? Elayla's busy. Oh, okay. Second week, where's that video? Back in the day, heads would have rolled. Come on. But I've mellowed out. I'm chilling out more now. Back in the day, I would have pulled the rod out a long time ago. So, yeah, 3 weeks. I said, okay, let's go with the program. I don't know what's going on. Yeah, so things we develop, we grow, we mature, we learn things. The rawness somehow is mellowed out. Some say it's a good thing, some say it's a bad thing. But nonetheless, we move on. We've got to be careful how we use our words. So Jesus spoke, by the time they went back to the house, the centurion's servant was healed. But Jesus commended this centurion for his faith. He believed, he didn't have to appear physically, believed the power of the word. And there is power in words, church. You can say a word here. There's an old saying about the butterfly effect. Have you heard of that? A butterfly flaps its wings in India and there's a storm in England because there's a consequence, cause and effect. There's a vibration. You can speak a word here and it will have an impact in different continent. You know that. You know, when we arrived in Africa, your eminences, after many years, we believed we only went there because of people's prayer. They said a prayer and we had the impact here and we responded to that prayer. Because something's happened that there's a mechanism is transcends our processes of understanding. It's the same way when I give the little illustration of, can God take the whole universe and put it in an egg without changing the size of the universe and changing the size of the... Yes, God can, because his physics and his mathematics are different to the way we see things. There's always different ways to see reality. Yeah? Okay? And so things are happening without your full awareness. And you can be praying here, but something can be happening in different parts of the country because the vibration does not stop. The sound goes. They know that. Even scientists know that. There's a vibration. There's a rhythm. So there's power in how we speak. You can say something negative about someone, and when they see you, they feel uncomfortable because your word has preceded you. You know, sometimes you say, I don't feel that person's vibes because their vibration is negative and conflicts. It becomes a discord with your vibration. And you can't gel. So first impressions, I don't feel comfortable. You've got a gut feeling that person doesn't like me or you don't like that person. And there's an understanding, an awareness of that, but you don't know what's happening. It's your vibration. And that's the power of the word. Praise God. That's why we're told Colossians chapter 4 verse 6 says this, let your speech always be with grace, seasoned with salt, that you may know how you ought to answer each one. So you need to be careful how we speak. Ephesians chapter 4 verse 29 says, let no corrupt word proceed out of your mouth. Why does Paul emphasize this? We're told in Colossians chapter 4 and we're told in Ephesians chapter 4. Why does he emphasize? Because he knows you implode, you damage yourself more than you damage the object of what you're speaking against. You know when you're unforgiving, you're hurting yourself more then you're hurting the person you're not forgiving. Did you know that? Yeah? Because you've got that embitterment. It's a poison. So it's better to let it go and forgive, move on, and just overcome that. But you can't do that without the Spirit of God helping you. That's why you need that relationship with God. Praise God. He says, let no corrupt word proceed out of your mouth, but what is good for necessary edification, that it may impart grace to the hearers. Paul emphasizes that numerous times. Proverbs 23 verse 7 says this, for as he thinks in his heart, so he is. So what you're saying, how you're thinking, determines what you are. That's why I said earlier, let the weak say they are strong. Don't confess what you see around you. Confess the promises of God and walk into that reality of what God is saying for you.
And I'm speaking from an experience. I'm not speaking lip service, textbook Christianity. I don't teach textbook Christianity. I teach experience. Okay? An example. We need to live by what we receive and show that example around. Example is a great teacher. Don't tell me what to do. Show me what to do. Yeah? Praise God. See the placebo effect. Someone gives you something, a medication or something, you believe that and you internalize it. And then you have an impact. More than not, often people have that positive development or progression. Because we want to trust somebody else's information. And even if you go to actually medicine that's got medicinal property in it, you still take it and you feel better after it. Whether it works or not, it's your mind that determines it. The power of your mind, the power of thought, the power of faith. Yeah? We have all these things going on around us. We know all this medication, all these things going on around us. But people are quickly jumping on the bandwagon. Oh, if you take this vaccine, if you take that, and all this, which I'm not touching upon that because I've spoken to people who know, who've developed it and things. I'm not touching on it. But I want to say something to you. How many of you, and I brought this here, take painkillers? Don't have to show me. Don't worry. Painkillers. Okay. Well, we go to the shop over the counter and we get a painkiller. Everyone's talking about side effects. Okay? And some people, they're against any medication, but that's fine. But the ones who do, we're talking about one particular medication or vaccine, but we take 100 more poisons. And we don't even think about that, but because Joe Bloggs has posted something, we straight away panic. Watch this, let me preach it. On a pack of cigarettes, it says smoking can seriously damage your health or can kill you. There. I'm not taking the vaccine. It's going to kill me. Yeah, you know all this conspiracy? I'm not going to take the vaccine. We're going to go on a big march now. Yeah, you're not going to give me a big poison. You're poisoning yourself. God called me to preach truth, not to be a cheerleader. I'm not going to be a cheerleader for people who do not think about the bigger picture. See, we're isolating one little point, but we miss the bigger picture. Watch this. Side effects. If you get any of the following side effects, stop taking the medicine. Okay. Let's see what the side effects are. Blurred vision. Sore throat. Coughing. Skin rash. Itchiness. Difficult breathing. Swelling of the face. We're quick to talk about things we do not know, but yet we go and take this and we think we're hypocrites. Connect with God and God will show you the right way to go. And if by chance there's an oversight, you take poison, the power of God can heal and transform you. Paul said to Timothy, a little wine for your stomach, but we listen to words and words can damage us. And damage other people. Yeah? That's why I always say to people, ask me, what should I do? I say, you get your facts and make your informed decision. I cannot tell you to do this, and I cannot tell you to do that. But I cannot give you an advice not to do something, because if I give you advice not to do something, and you die in the process, I take responsibility. So you have to make your own decision. If you don't take it, God bless you. If you do take it, God bless you. It doesn't matter, but you, as long as you've done it with your heart, your conviction is clear in yourself, that's what's important. It's not my role to tell you to do this or not to do this. Because I recall organizations many years ago were stopping children from doing blood transfusions. And children were dying. So we have an argument for it. I'm just speaking about the power of words now. I'm just talking about how we hear things and we act upon them. Yeah? And we've got to become responsible for ourselves. Be prayerful. Get to know God. And when you know God, things change properly. We're not becoming nominal Christians. We become spirit-filled Christians, that we move in the spirit, and we move in from a place of love, and changes everything. If I didn't know God, I couldn't last 1 week in the ministry. The challenges I faced in my life. You don't know this, and I wouldn't put it upon you. You don't know what I had been through. You don't know the obstacles I had to overcome. You don't know the powers that came. You don't know these things. But many of these people do. Okay? Even so-called Christian brothers came against me because I published a book that was too advanced spiritually for them. And it was standing outside the Christian bookshops with leaflets campaigning to stop people buying my book. We were getting it through Premier Radio, and they were writing to Premier to stop publishing my book because it was too spiritual. So if you have the war wounds, I've got enough. But God made a way where there's no way, praise God. Praise the Lord. So we need to confess the promises of God. So in closing today, I want you to think about the promises of God for your life. For your lives. And I want to give you a few food for thought for you. First of all, say from today, whether spiritually, physically, emotionally, my poverty days are over. Come, make that confession. My poverty days are over. Whether body, soul, my poverty days are over. You serve a God that can do more than you can ask or think. Your poverty days are over. As from today, I'm not going to complain, but I'm going to celebrate the goodness of God in my life. I'm not going to look at what's negative. I'm going to look at what's positive, and I'm going to look to God. I'm not going to be a naysayer. I'm not going to be a fearmonger. I'm going to be celebrating. I'm going to be speaking about Jesus. I'm not going to be speaking about demons and being possessed by demons. When Christ is in me, I'm a new creation, and everything old has passed away, and everything has become new. Praise God. Oh, I'm going to walk in the promise of God. I'm going to walk in the power of the Holy Spirit. No weapon fashioned against me will prosper, and every tongue that rises against me, I will be cut off. That's what it's about. Come on, come on. And Dave jumped on the mantra of David. He said, David said, ye though walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they cover me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemy. That's the God we serve. The reason I speak like this, because I know him. I know the power of his might. He gave me sleep, and he made me wake up. He gives me breath. Oh, hallelujah. Praise God. Do not be anxious for anything. Oh, hallelujah. But in every situation, not just some, from the minute detail, any situation, make your request known to God. Oh, hallelujah. Praise God. With thanksgiving. If you may not get the outcome, but thank the Lord. And he'll give you the peace that transcends your understanding, praise God. Oh, hallelujah, praise God. Yes, hallelujah. This is the day the Lord has made. We shall rejoice. Hallelujah. And be glad. Oh, hallelujah. James chapter 1 verse 5 says this, if any of you lacks wisdom, you should ask God, who gives generously to all without finding fault, and it will be given to you. Petition the Lord. This is the day the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. Take delight in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your hearts. Wow. Desire the good things, church. Please, desire the good things. I want to finish on a song. I don't normally come to that point. I want to finish on a song now. I want to praise him just to stand. I want to finish on this song. Because you need to know who you are. There's a song that says, I know who I am. Yeah, I know. You can stand and dance in your seats where you are. Praise the Lord. If we just get that song ready, I know who I am, praise God. Now, I want you to listen to the words of this song. When you're singing them, make that confession who you are. No, there's no power in the universe that transcends what God has done for you. I'm telling you. Hallelujah, praise God. I know who I am. Let's stand together. I want to finish on this song. Hallelujah. Let's just lift up. Remember, before we sing, when you say something, you're birthing it. The word to say, veyoma in Hebrew, is to give birth. So when you speak positive things, good things, encouraging things. And you see, not just your life, but other people's lives will be transformed. Let's sing. We are a chosen generation. Let's sing. Come.
We are a chosen generation, called forth to show His excellence. All I require for life, God has given me. I know who I am. We are a chosen generation, called forth to show His excellence. All I require for life, God has given me. I know who God says I am, what He says I am, where He says I'm at. I know who I am, I know who God says I am, what He says I am, where He says I'm at. I know who I am.
I'm walking in power, I'm walking in miracles, I live a life of favor.
I know who I am.
I'm walking in power, I'm walking in miracles, I live a life of favor.
I know who I am.
We are a chosen generation, called forth to show His excellence. All I require for life, God has given me, and I know who I am. We are a chosen generation, called forth to show His excellence. All I require for life, God has given me. I know who I am.
Do you know who you are? You are a child of the living God. You are a heavenly citizen. You are seated in Christ Jesus at the right hand of God the Father in the heavenly places. Do you know who you are? You are more than a conqueror. Hallelujah. Praise the God. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. You have a great inheritance. Praise God. So don't, whenever anything, trial, challenge, whatever happens, know who you are. Praise God. And it's not just being proud and arrogant. It's being real. We talk about being real. It's being real. If you are confess Christ as your Savior, He's in your hearts, you are a living child of God. You are Christ's example in the world, praise God. And God makes a difference in our life. I'm going to do one more song, actually. Hear My Cry, O Lord. Amen. Let's lift that one as well, since everyone's standing.
Hear my cry, O Lord, attend to my prayer. From the ends of the earth will I
when my heart is overwhelmed, lead me.
Lead me. Lead me to the rock that is higher than I. That is higher than I.
For thou hast been.
For thou hast been. A shelter for me.
A strong tower from the enemy.
strong tower.
Run, church, run. In the name of the Lord.
When my heart is overwhelmed, lead me to the rock that is higher than I. That is higher than I.
Let's lead the Lord with a clap offering. Praise God. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Please take your seats. I'm just going to ask the ministers, Bishop-elect Leo, to come forward as well. And just to come, we're going to pray collectively together, Bishop-elect and also the bishops, archbishops and bishops. Just to come, I just want to pray. I'm going to do something different this week, just to pray together for all of you. And I'm going to ask one of them as a spokesman for the ministry to pray for all of us, including myself. If you come forward to the stage, Bishop, archbishops and bishop and Bishop-elect. Yes, come. Praise God. And I'm going to ask His Eminence on behalf of all the ministers to pray for us and thank God for what He's done through our lives. I'm no different than anyone else, and I'm humbled by the wonderful acknowledgements with all the wonderful people I've worked with over the years, and thank God for their lives. And I pray that you will all be included in the next how many years yet to go, whatever the time scales, but we want to be a part of what God is doing. There's revival in the land, so God bless you. Your Eminence, would you pray for on behalf of all the ministers, please?
Hallelujah. It's a good celebration and a good message. And the placebo effects. When the pandemic started and the rule of vaccines came, I was asked by the health authority in Haringey to speak to the black community about the vaccinations, because everybody's calling me, it's 666, we are not taking it. And somebody called me that if you take it and you don't die, then I will take it. I said, okay. And I spoke to the GP, and I said to the GP, GP, you don't know what? In Ghana, there's a placebo effect. Our parents, when they go to hospital, the doctor can prescribe every medicine to them. Without injection, you are not a good doctor. So if you prescribe, even with a water, and they are injected, they are healed. So this is the same effect going on. So today, now, the message has come. Power of your words. Let's land up with Jeremiah. Jeremiah went through a lot of challenges in his ministry. He's the prophet who suffered more than every prophet. But Lamentation chapter 3 verse 21 says, "This I recall unto my mind. Therefore I have hope that the loving kindness of the Lord never ceases. His mercy never come to an end. They are new every morning. Great is thy faithfulness." Hallelujah. Let us stand up. And just stretch your hands upon the Archbishop and all the ministers. You pray for us. Thank God for our lives, including me. Stretch your hands and pray for us. The challenges that His Eminence has gone through the 20 years of being consecrated as a bishop. He has gone through wilderness. He has climbed mountains. He has sailed through oceans in life. And yet there's yet another land for him to occupy. Pray. Prophesy blessing upon our life. Pray that we be strengthened. Because you don't know what is happening in our ministries. You don't know what is happening in our homes. But we dress and put on the collar and smile. And give you hope. But you don't know what is happening at our end. And everything else comes up. You are a minister. You are a pastor. You don't know. But you don't know. Many of us are crying. Many of us are facing challenges in our home, in our family life. But today, as we celebrate the 20 years of Archbishop consecration as a bishop, let's pray. Thank God for our life. That the God continue to sustain us. This I recall to my mind. That's our hope.
Sometimes people are giving up and no ministers who are dying slowly because the challenge is too great. It's not a place where they pamper you. Sleepless nights. When you are encountering challenge, somebody will call you. I need a prayer. And you have to wipe away your tears and support the person. Stretch your pray and thank God.
Yes.
How sweet the name of Jesus sound in the believer's ear. He shows his sorrow, heals his wounds, and drives away his fear. It makes the wounded spirit whole and calms the troubled breast. Tis manna to the hungry soul and to the weary rest. Dear name, the rock on which I build my shield and hiding place, my never failing treasure filled with boundless thoughts of grace. Jesus, my shepherd, guardian, friend, my prophet, priest, and king, my Lord, my life, my way, my end. Accept the praise I pray. Weak is the effort of my heart and cool my warmest thought. But when I see thee at thy heart, I'll praise you as I will. Till then I would thy love proclaim with every fleeting breath, and may the music of thy name refresh my soul in death. Father in heaven, we thank you for today as we receive the congregational prayers. We thank you for your son, Archbishop Dr. Evangelou Kosakis, for his 20 years anniversary of his consecration as a bishop. He has sailed through oceans in life. He has climbed many mountains. And you have brought him here today. Ebenezer, you have been a helping stone. We thank God for his life. There are many, many, many rivers for him to cross. But with your strength, with your power, he will go through. Father, we pray for double anointing upon his life. Continue to increase him in knowledge, wisdom, and understanding. That when he speaks, people will be delivered. People will be blessed. When you walk through the valley of the shadow of death and know you will be with him. My Lord, today, as we celebrate this great occasion, we use him as a point of contact to all of us, all our ministries, all our offices. We thank God for today. Father, let us, the message that will come from our mouth be a blessing, not a curse. Whatever we are encountering, we will be positive. And we will thank God. May your name be glorified. We pray over the whole congregation. We thank God for their life. As they are praying for us today, let every plan or let every dream they have be accomplished. May your name be glorified. And let the church say amen.
Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. I don't know whether to tell you to stand up or to sit down. The choice, like His Eminence said, is yours. In such a time like this, I cannot help but admire the beauty of the Lord that we serve. And seeing his handiwork in the person of His Eminence, Archbishop Dr. Kostakis, tells me who our God is. God is all-knowing, all-seeing, all-powerful. He does not need a mirror to see himself. But when he sees you, he sees his reflection. for we were made in his image. We thank you, your eminence, for portraying the image of God in you to us. And as a proud Ghanaian and as a very good friend of his eminence, not only in the natural, but also as a co-worker in the vineyard, I want to say this on behalf of my country, Ghana. You see, there is a piece of cloth in Ghana that is called the kente. The colors are carefully chosen and they are woven together by hand. And that is a symbol of respect. And so I have a piece of cloth here to present to His Eminence Archbishop. Hallelujah. It might not be much, but it is the symbol of this kente that speaks. As you can see the colors of the kente, every thread of this was chosen carefully and it was woven by hand. And so these days everything has become fashion, so we don't see the value of a kente. But in my father's and my grandfather's time, when somebody gives you a kente, it means everything. And so, your eminence, I give you this piece. I know you've been given the kente cloth in Ghana, but here in the UK, I want you to remember that you are part and parcel of the culture of the Ghanaian society. We thank you.
Praise God.
Also, when I was coming, I didn't know what His Eminence was going to speak about, but there was something in my heart that the Lord led me to talk about. Even though I did not write this myself, but it's a reflection of what I would have said or write myself. And so this is a piece of a little gift that when you take it home and place it by your door, fridge, wherever, anytime you see, you remember the friendship that God has given unto us. And because you spoke about the power of the word, I will speak on the power of the word here. I say, friends bring out the beautiful things in each other that nobody else look hard enough to find. Your eminence, I can see the hand of God in your life. This is for you. Thank you very much for being a part and parcel of your inner circles. God continue to bless you for many, many more years to come. Amen.
Actually, to have that, our communion, it's amazing actually, Archbishop Edmund, because you know, this is it, kente,
yeah.
It's made it for Louis Vuitton on their catwalk is using the Ghanaian cloth,
yes.
So Lizzie's a fashion model as well also. Praise God, there's real joy in the house. I'm so blessed, and these two brothers have really walked beside us as a ministry. And we just want to thank God. There's celebration. We're going to come to have our communion now. Let's do this with joy, real joy, because this is the day that the Lord has made. And we're rejoicing and we are glad in it. And as we have our communion, then we're going to take our seats. We have a special cake. It's a biscuit. It's almond, actually. It's the Greek macaroon. And we've ordered one for all of us because their Archbishop's one of his favourite. So as we take your seats, they're going to be handed out for each one of you because we cannot cut a cake or anything because of these regulations. So please stay in your seats and we'll give you a cake also. And when you eat it today, know that you are part of a great revival. A great revival, a church on fire. And so we want to thank God today. God bless you.
Amen. Amen. You have your communion. Your hand, let me read the Bible verse. Matthew chapter 26, verse 26 says, and as they were eating, Jesus took bread, blessed, and broke it, and gave it to the disciples, and said, take, eat, this is my body. Then he took the cup, and gave thanks, and gave it to them, saying, drink from it, all of you, for this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for many for the remission of sins. May the Lord bless each and every one as you open it. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. Amen.
rest of your hand up about to the senior pastor.
And if the ministers would like to take their seats, God bless you. This is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. Rejoice in the Lord. Of the Lord, He is worthy to be praised. Celebrate the presence of the Lord, He is worthy to be praised. Rejoice, rejoice in the Lord, in the Lord. Rejoice, we rejoice in the
goodness of Jesus and all He's done for me. My very soul shouts hallelujah. Praise God. He lifted me.
You're younger than us. You should be thinking of songs more current. These are our ones.
I've become old school.
All right.
When I think of the goodness of Jesus
and what He has done
and what He has done for me,
my
very soul shall shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah,
praise God for saving me.
When I
think of the goodness of Jesus and what He has done for me,
my very soul
shall shout so happy, no sorrow inside. Praise the Lord, I saw the light.
Like running, jumping, praising the Lord
for what He's done for me. He has set my spirit free. I feel like running, jumping, praising the Lord for what He has done for me. Lord, He left in me, my sins are forgiven, and now I'm free. Oh, praise the Lord, my shackles are gone, my spirit is free.
He set me free
one day, He set me free.
He broke
the bars of prison for me.
Someday
in glory's face I shall see. Glory be to God, He set me free.
Hallelujah. Praise God. Have you all taken a macaroon? Shall we share the grace? Hallelujah. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with each one of us now and forevermore. And surely goodness and mercy shall follow us all the days of our lives, and we will dwell in the house of the Lord forever and ever and ever. Let's give him a mighty clap offering. If you'd like to take your seats, we also have Sister Ruth has kindly donated some of these golden chocolate bunnies. So